So good morning. So my name is Charles Tu from UC San Diego. I also would like to thank Yonghang for organizing this historical event. It is so wonderful to see so many old friends from earlier days, at least my earlier days. Yeah. So it's an honor for me to chair the second half of the MBE in early days by MBE pioneers. And our first speaker is Professor Satoshi Hiyamizu. Now, Professor Hiyamizu obtained his bachelor and PhD degrees from Osaka University. Then he went to Fujitsu Laboratories. Now, earlier, Tom Foxon mentioned the fundamental physical studies with high electromobility of two-dimensional electron gas. Well, Professor Satoshi Hiyamizu, actually, with his colleague, Dr. Mimura, demonstrated first the high electron mobility transistor. And for this, he won the Lieberman Award from the IEEE. So, and after Fujitsu, he went to Osaka University as a professor. And so let's welcome Professor Hiyamizu. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So today I'd like to just a story of the birth of high speed device transistor HEM. Okay, so just this is some historical situations of Japan in 1970s. At those days, Japanese economy was still growing so strongly. So many companies were very rich and they have monies. So there exists some so-called central lab boom among companies. Many central labs were set up in Japan. And people thought that somewhat basic research also can be done in a company beside the application research. Okay, so MBE research started in several companies, including Fujitsu Lab, around 1974. So, and at those days, Fujitsu Lab used vapor phase epitaxy and liquid phase epitaxy for growing material. But people feel that high potential of MBE for growing new materials, especially the mud pool layers, such as super lattice, was very, very attractive. So, but we didn't have any clear target of HEM research. So anyway, we start MBE, okay. in those days, this is the comment on MBEs. Researchers, yeah, we have MBEs. It's a very wonderful scientific tool. And the management side of labs, it's high cost and no return. And also management side of production division, more severe. It's, yeah, indeed, it's high tech, but not reliable. This is just in 1970s, okay? No, now. And with a high vacuum, it's a terrible, they thought. And one atomic layer by one atomic layer growth, it it's not practical. And so this is a very common feeling. It is difficult to use MBE in the factory. So this negative feeling about MBE is very, very serious for the MBE researchers in company. Okay, so we start MBE research as a new project. Okay. Anyway, the allowed time is just 5 years. Just 5 years. And the first year check and third year check and the fifth year check. It's just that the final check is very, very serious. So if we didn't good result, so we must stop it. Okay. Anyway, so then we start MBE research in Fujitsu Labs. In 1974, we surveyed the MBE technologies. And based on the information given by Dr. Cho's papers, mainly. We designed our homemade MBE machine, okay, and ordered it to vacuum instrument companies. And in 1975, we installed our homemade MBE machines. So the we used the graphite crucible, graphite cells for gallium, arsenic, and tin sources. And we just start the growth of gallium arsenide. Okay, this is the diagram of, this is four furnace flange and one furnace arsenic flange and substrate holders. Okay, so, and this is the pictures of our homemade machine in 1975. Okay, so this is four furnace flange, and this is arsenic source flange. Okay, so and this is manipulators of substrate holders. So we have to break vacuum, open the growth chambers to exchange substrate every time. So this is our four furnace flange. Okay, this is very complicated. and this is furnace, and we used graphite crucible, okay. And this is the liquid nitrogen cooled furnace shroud. So in our system, the four furnaces were isolated with each other by the liquid nitrogen shroud. So demerit is a very large consumption of liquid nitrogen. It's very expensive. So this is just arsenic furnace. And this is inside of the growth chamber. Okay. This is OJs, and this is spectrogun, this is mass spectrometers. And so on. This is just our heat gun, maybe. Okay, so in 1976, we added interlock system for exchange substrate, road rod. And we start silicon doped, tin doped spindle of gallium arsenide. And also, we made gallium arsenide MESFET. spindle of gallium arsenide showed very high uniformity, much higher than that of the vapor epitaxy grown gallium arsenide. But the gallium arsenide MESFETs show the performance almost comparable to VPE MESFETs. So no advantage of MBEs. MBEs very, very expensive, and running cost is also expensive. So we always require good results. So comparable is no good. Okay. So we changed the material from gallium arsenide to indium gallium arsenide. And 1977, we made indium gallium arsenide, gallium arsenide home junction lasers. And this is also comparable to vapor phase epitaxy or liquid phase epitaxy lasers. yeah, we did. Indeed, we got the diverse quality indium gallium arsenide with the use of my, our MB system, but it takes about 40 hours to grow the 10 microns of lasers. So my boss said it's useless. So in these days, we couldn't show any advantage of MBE. So more effort were required. So we changed again the material, indium gallium arsenide to gallium arsenide. Okay, so in 1978, we grew the gallium arsenide on thermal oxide masked gallium arsenide substrate. This is just a selective growth of gallium arsenide on gallium arsenide, and high resistive polycrystalline gallium arsenide on oxide film. But it is not so so strong impact. So anyway, in 1979, this is the fifth year. So we tried to grow the highly uniform pin-doped gallium arsenide on large gallium arsenide substrate for gallium arsenide logic application. So we got high uniformity just by separate the substrate and source, something like 20 centimeter or so, so long. So anyway, and then no substrate voltage. And but high uniformity, yes, but this is also comparable ion implanted gallium arsenide substrate. The ion implantation was also a new technique, but it was already used in silicon processes. So it have a very high throughput, and also very reliable technique. So anyway, in 1979, some other companies stopped MBE research in Japan in this year. Okay? So we also just hanging by a single thread. Okay? And time limit, just the end of the 1979. We're approaching, and so what should we do next? So that is the program. And okay, this is just Miss Dr. Mimura. Mimura belonged to a semiconductor device group. So we belong to a semiconductor material group, so different group, okay? And Mimura's research was also at the turning point in 1979. Mimura had studied gallium arsenide MOSFET as a next generation high-speed device since 1975, I'm unsure. Around here. But his study came to a deadlock in 1979. Okay. And he had also much interest in high mobility two-dimensional electron gas in MV-grown modulation doped gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide superlattice reported by Dingo in 1978. And Mimura had his basic idea of HEMT based on his research of gallium arsenide MOSFET in 1979. Okay. Of course, he had no information about real two-dimensional electron gas in MV-grown gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide heterostructure. Anyway, these materials didn't exist in Fujitsu at that time, right? So we had an informal meeting for developing HEMT for the first time on August 7th. In 1979. So, Mimura asked me to collaborate for developing HEMT by showing his basic idea of the device structure. And the MV group was just ready for growing gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide heterostructure. Just ready. And no experience. Okay? And he needed MBE's material. And we need a good target. So the collaboration started. And so we modified MBE machine in 1979 to grow the high quality gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide material. So upward furnace for gallium aluminum silicon sources. So in this experiment, aluminum and the silicon source, we use this for the first time. Just for the first time. And also, pyrolytic boronitride crucible is also first time we used. And and for high uniformities, the increased distance between substrate and sources. up to 28 centimeters. And interlock is already installed. So this is the some situations of our MBS machine in 1979. Okay, this is a picture of our MB system. This is four furnace flange, okay, so upward. And this is arsenic port. And this is the interlock system. And this is big valve. Okay. We are just only one system, and we use to modify. No additional MB system. We couldn't get. So just one MB system. Okay. So so this is just activities after the meeting. So August modification of MB machine, and September we grow silicon dope gram arsenide, and also silicon dope aluminum gram arsenide. In October, gallium arsenide and silicon dope aluminum gram arsenide heterostructures structures, and also characterizations of these material. And in November, we supplied hemp epi wafer, two epi wafers. Okay? And structure is just so-called inverse structures. That is, the undoped gallium arsenide is top layer, and the second layer is silicon doped aluminum gallium arsenide. Because the Memura asked the top layer should be gallium arsenide for the first time, because he hesitated to make a Schottky gate on aluminum gallium arsenide. He has no experience. Okay? So he want to the put the short gate on gallium arsenide. So the inverse structures he required for the first time. But in these two cases, the device didn't work. So in December, we supplied the third hemp epi wafer to him, and this is the normal structures. Aluminum gallium arsenide is the top layer, and the second layer is gallium arsenide. And it showed the two-dimensional electron gas mobility of 32,500 at 7K. And with the use of this epi wafer, the successful performance of MBE was obtained in just the 28th December, just the end of the 1979. And so this is first demonstration of hemp. So this is hemp IV characteristics. So room temperature and 77K. So at low temperatures, hemp showed very enhanced transconductance due to the increased two-dimensional electron gas mobilities. And this is gallium arsenide MESFET. Okay. So we are very lucky, and our MBE machine operated without any trouble for as long as 4 months, from September to December. So typically, we had one or two trouble a month. So this is a very unusual. And so we could supply the materials, hemp materials, in a very short time. And so we are very in time. And the MBE group survived in Fujitsu laboratory, and hemp project formally started in April 1980. So this is Mimura and me, and more than 30 years ago, and rich hair, and the black hair. Anyway, we are very lucky. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a wonderful story about the history of hemp. Yeah. So our next, I should mention that all the three speakers in this session were all Ultra MBE Award winners. Yeah. So our next speaker is Professor Professor Horikoshi. Professor Horikoshi obtained his PhD in engineering from University of Tokyo, and then he went to NTT laboratories. And I still remember his generosity when I visited him. So he is best known for MEE, or Migration Enhanced Epitaxy. So let us welcome Professor Horikoshi. So he's from Waseda University.
Thank you very much for kind introduction. I'm very much honored to be invited here as one of the pioneers of MBE. I'd like to say thank you very much to Professor Johansson and all the organizing committee members for making such a chance, as I have to speak something here, which I never expected. So, but I feel I'm not worthy to be counted as pioneers, because as in fact, as a previous speaker's story, important works on MBE had been done 60s to 70s, but I started my work, MBE work, very late. So actually, I came to the MBE world in 1980. So I'd like to start my talk with what I was doing when the pioneers were working on MBE. First, let me introduce myself shortly. I got a PhD in 1971 and joined NTT Basic Research Laboratories. First 10 years in NTT, I was worked on liquid phase epitaxy for compound semiconductors, for lasers, for optical communication. Mainly, first we did for the aluminum gallium arsenide system, and due to the progress in optical fibers, we switched the material to indium gallium arsenide phosphide, indium phosphide system for 1.5 micron wavelength. Afterwards, we extended our work to the much longer wavelength region, infrared region, by using narrow gap 3-5 compound semiconductors and also lead-in terrified material. In 1980, we moved from MBE to LPE to MBE or MVP for also lasers and FETs. During this time, we developed migration enhanced epitaxy, ME, and FME. This is flow rate modulation epitaxy, and this is a MVP version of MEE. And 1996, I got a position at Wasabi University and concentrated on MVE for nanostructures. In 2009, we extend our work to solar cells and worked with aluminum gallium arsenide, and copper indium selenide, copper gallium selenide nanostructures for solar cell application. So first, let me touch on shortly the liquid phase epitaxy. This is a very different area for you. And this work was done for making lasers for optical communication with gallium arsenide and other these materials. And to grow, for example, aluminum gallium arsenide, double hetero structures, we used multi-beam sliding board system. This was invented in very laboratories, very old days, and this was proved to be useful for making good laser material. And differently saturated melt settled like this, and substrate is contacted to the melt one by one. So we can make multi-layers. And in this case, when one melt is changed to the next one, we can move the slide substrate holder and mechanically wipe off the melt. In that case, imperfect wiping off often occurs. And then intermittent mixing occurs. As a result, inhomogeneous composition layers and also sometimes scratches on the surface is appearing because of the constitutional supercooling. And in some cases, this kind of very bad pattern can be obtained. This is a photoluminescence pattern, and the scratch part is very dark lines like shown here. This is fatal damage to the laser material. To solve this problem, we developed a new board system we call wipingless board, LP system. In this case, the melt is injected from the reservoir to the melt room on the substrate. And when the layer is changed, the next layer, only the reservoir was exchanged. So we don't have to wipe off the melt on the surface, except for the final layer. And effect of this was very nice. The uniform composition and uniform sequence layers can be obtained on the whole wafer. And most important point is the yield of the devices is surprisingly increased with this method. So in 1980, I joined the MB group led by Mr. Okamoto in NTT Basic Research Laboratories. And soon after my joining the MB group, people from Bell Laboratories visited us for the bilateral relationship. And in that case, Professor Cho came with them, member of the visitor. And he encouraged me by saying that those who are working on LPE is very welcome to the MB field, because phase problems are a lot of phase problems in MBE. So this one word encouraged me a lot. Thank you very much. So in 1982, second ICMBE was held in Tokyo. And after this conference, Mr. Ploog came to visit our laboratory, and research exchange plan was discussed between Professor Ploog and Professor Okamoto. And according to the agreement, I visited Max Planck Institute next year. I joined Mr. Ploog's laboratory, and I learned a lot about MBE that time. And most of our interesting discussion we did was delta doping and monolayer structures, because it is very difficult to make by MBE flat layers. Atomically flat layers is very difficult to make with MBE. So how to make such flat layers were discussed a lot. And at this time, the very, very surprising report was done by Mr. Suntora, called atomic layer epitaxy. This is 1984, but he actually invented this method early 70s. So he showed me very uniform thin films of 2-6 compound film on the letter size glass. I'm very much impressed in his work. So other people also very much impressed, and the impact of LE was so large that many attempts were made for 3-5 compound semiconductors, gallium arsenide in particular. And but most of the trials were not successful. This is because it takes very long time to achieve complete group three molecule the saturation. And also, ground layers suffer from high level contamination by carbon. So these were caused by the metal organic compounds materials, such as TEG, TMG, or TMA, triethyl gallium, trimethyl gallium. So we want to solve this problem. So to solve this problem, we plan to deposit pure metals instead of compound molecules. So in this case, we cannot expect the one monolayer saturation, adsorption saturation, because this is metallic material. But metallic deposition on semiconductors show normally SK mode nature. So if we deposit one monolayer deposition on substrate, flat monolayers can be achieved in the very quickly. So this by repeating this deposition, we can make growing surface very flat. Yeah. So, but in this case, very large stress will be imposed on the shutters. So because if we grow 1 micron gallium arsenide, more than 4,000 times of shutter action for gallium and arsenic. So we need some improvement. But after return to NTT laboratories, I found that very unlucky. I found that there is no good MB machine in our group. Instead, there are some very nice MBO CVD machines. So, the effect of MBE was first examined by using MBO CVD system. But at the same time, we designed a new MB system appropriate for MEE. But to apply MOVP system to MEE, there are many points to be improved. One is, this is very important, rapid gas flow switching is very inevitable. So this is done by to use special valve and place the valve as close to the chamber as possible. So second one is monitoring method to monitor guarantee the one monolayer deposition, and also this is the substrate temperatures to achieve full decomposition of metal organics. By doing this kind of improvement, we try to grow gallium arsenide by ME, and the effect is very clear. The uniform thickness was achieved very easily for the 2-inch wafer, and also electric properties is much better than the MOVP counterparts. So, but most surprising result was it is quite useful for area selective epitaxy. I'll talk later. And we named this method flow rate modulation epitaxy, FME. So this is one demonstration of the area selective epitaxy by FME. This is growth of aluminum 0.5, gallium 0.5 arsenic hexagon disks on 111B substrate. When we use the FME, very clear the hexagon can be obtained. But under the same condition, using MOVP, the polycrystalline deposition is formed on SiO2 and also periphery. So it is very useful to use for the the area selected by epitaxy. In this case, the aluminum percentage is 0.5, but even for the pure aluminum arsenide, nice epitaxy can be obtained. So by combining the aluminum gallium arsenide hexagon and also gallium arsenide hexagon, we can make a quantum wells or double heterostructures very easily. By making this way, we made the hexagonal laser disk like here. This shows the emission spectrum of two disks were excited, and this was only 3 picojoule the threshold, and the emission occurs in the total reflection mode like this. And this is a near field pattern of the disk array. And the last one spectrum is the emission from each hexagon. And uniformity seems very nice. Now, in the beginning of 1986, our new MBE machine is settled. And we start to use MBE by MBE machine. And usefulness of ME deposition sequence was confirmed already through FME experiments. But in this case, we can lower the temperature a lot because we use only metallic sources. And as I mentioned, the essence of ME is to deposit gallium under arsenic-free condition. And interesting phenomena of gallium deposition without arsenic was reported by Bruce Joyce and Tom Foxon, and also Fernando Briones until this time. So let me explain the alternate deposition of gallium and arsenic. This is this experiment was done in 580 degrees C and looking at the lead spectral beam intensity. Before the experiment, the surface is exposed to arsenic, and at t equals zero, time zero, starting point, the arsenic was stopped, and gallium deposition started for a short time. And after a while, the arsenic was again deposited. In this course of this experiment, lead spectral beam intensity drops when the gallium deposition starts, and when the arsenic deposition is started again, the intensity recovers to the original value. But this recovery process is very dependent upon the amount of the gallium deposited in this sequence. And when the deposited gallium atoms are commensurate, that means only one monolayer, or not exactly, but nearly one monolayer or two monolayers, the recovery occurs very quickly to the original value. But when it is incommensurate like this, the steep recovery is followed by very slow recovery. After the arsenic deposition, the surface reconstruction changes from 4x2 to 2x4. So this means that this slow recovery is the level of intensity of this area was due to the flatness of the surface. Arsenic stabilized surface. So this slow recovery in commensurate deposition means that the small island is coalescing, agglomerating to the large islands. This process is shown here. This tells us that if we repeat one monolayer gallium deposition and arsenic, so we can keep the surface flatness very nice. This is an example of ME growth on gallium arsenide at 580 degrees C. As shown here, in the gallium deposition process, 4x2, and in arsenic deposition process, 2x4. And at the end of the intensity of the arsenic deposition is the same to the end of the growth. This means this level directly shows the flatness of the surface. So surface flatness will be kept to the end of the growth. This diagram shows the effect of incommensurate deposition. When the deposition is commensurate, the upper figures, in this case, the oscillation is continuous to the end of the growth. But when the amount is reduced to 80% of surface size, this kind of modulation occurs. And this modulation occurs every 5 cycles. That means in 5 cycles, we have complete four monolayers. So when the deposition rate is reduced to half monolayer per cycle, the every other peaks after arsenic deposition increases like this. This means that surface roughness will be, this means the one monolayer may be completed by 2 cycles, 0.5 micron, 0.5 monolayer deposition. This means that surface roughness will be kept one monolayer at most, regardless of the deposition rate. This point is very important because the in MEE, the deposition of exact one monolayer is very difficult. But if it is deviated, the top surface is flatness may be only one monolayer. Roughness is only one monolayer. This is because of this characteristic, the flatness of the surface is very nice without substrate rotation. So as with the FME case, the MEE is very effective for area selective epitaxy too. And this is due to the fact that the gallium is more easily evaporated from gallium arsenide surface, substrate surface, compared with, gallium is easily evaporated from SiO2 mask compared with the polycrystals. Therefore, nanostructures is very small sizes were grown. Our inner growth, the minimum was about 100 nanometer across, as shown here. So this is due to the e-beam lithography limit. And mistake. Effect of molecules of arsenic species. It is easy to grow gallium nanowires when it is the arsenic 2 is used instead of arsenic 4. This is because the arsenic 2 is difficult to make trimers on the surface. Therefore, the growth to 111B is enhanced. So this kind of nanowires can be easily obtained by arsenic 2. But using arsenic 4, normal the tiny structures can be produced. This shows the thin quantum dot growth of ME. Thin quantum dot is a very tiny structure, of course, 10 nanometer or so. Therefore, it is very difficult to make lithography. But we make the pyramid-like growth on the surface, and on the top of the small pyramid, we make very tiny plateau. And that area, we can make indium arsenide dots growth. By doing this, the single contact dot can be obtained on the top of the pyramid. And this spectrum is obtained on the this substrate surface. The pyramid is made like this, and on top, small dots. And this is a typical spectrum from this kind of structure. And each peak corresponds to the one dot. The line width is, for example, 250 microelectron volt. This is really large than pure single dot. But this is due to the system resolution. So finally, I'd like to show you the very important point of low temperature deposition. ME uses a metallic source in solid source MBE. Low temperature growth is done. And actually, gallium arsenide growth was achieved at 200 to 300 degrees C. If it is at some minimum temperature that requires for reaction of arsenic and gallium, if the temperature is overcome this barrier, we can make deposition like this. And when in this case we use the conventional deposition upper traces, and this is when the optimum arsenic is used, this is 3.4 times 10 to the 14th per square centimeter. In this case, we have constant amplitude oscillation is obtained to the end of the growth. And this is just like as high temperatures. And when the arsenic 4 is a little bit more excess, in that case, some modulation appears. This is due to excess arsenic adsorption. And the result of low temperature growth is, for example, high quality quantum wells and also low threshold lasers can be achieved by this method. And also high thermal stability is obtained. I mean, even for the layers grown at 300 degrees C, it doesn't change even after heat treatment at 800 degrees C. But this needs very accurate arsenic control. If we use excess arsenic, in this case, we have some deterioration by sample annealing. So by using only the excess arsenic problem, the very nice layers can be obtained by at these low temperatures. So I told today for journey from LP to MBE, but it is not finished yet. I'm still seeking for new applications, new understandings, and also new methods. So these are my collaborators. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Horikoshi, for giving a history of MEE. So now our next speaker is Professor Klaus Ploog. Professor Ploog obtained his bachelor degree in chemistry from University of Keio, and a PhD also in chemistry from University of Mannheim. And then after a while, he joined Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart until, and then he became a director there, and then later director of Paul Drew Institute. So, Professor Ploog.
So, hello everybody. I think after all, I will not give a scientific talk. I will just give you a very brief overview about the history of MBE in Germany, particularly at the Max Planck Institute. You see here that we started in October 1973 with the planning to establish an MBE system in Stuttgart of the newly established Max Planck Institute for Solid State Research. And I had been working at the research center of Jülich on nuclear diffraction on some compounds. And I'm a chemist, as you heard already. So I started my job in January. And my job was to build up an MBE system. So we made inquiries to Ribera, Varian, and VG for UHV systems. There was no MBE system available. You had to purchase an UHV system. So Varian dropped out almost immediately because their quotation was approximately double price compared to the rest, to VG and Ribera. So I visited both companies. I think it was in February 1974. And when I visited VG in UK, it was just in the middle of the strike of the coal miners. So I could visit the company only for a few hours on the day when there was daylight. So our decision back in Germany was, this was a little bit too risky to order a system at VG. Maybe it would have been delivered in 1 year's time or so. So our decision was made for repair. So, okay. So in autumn 1974, a custom designed UHV system was delivered, which was built by repair, included read, quarter one mass spectrometer with an ion gun for SIMS, and also OG electron spectroscopy. So, and it was delivered actually into a laboratory which was located next to the original institute's building. It was in a warehouse, and you will hear more about it by Albrecht Fischer in the afternoon. So during that time, we had to design, to construct and manufacture a fusion cells, which were not available. You have heard about it. And also about that, you will hear a little bit more in the afternoon. And in summer 75, we actually relocated our MB system into the new building of the institute, which was located in Jülich. Okay, let me see. So, this was a system. We designed the system for vertical evaporation. So this was different from El Cho's design. You can see here, the quadruple mass spectrometer reads green here. Okay, this is from the other side. This is a read gun here. We designed a 50 kV, of course. Everybody is aiming big, because we were reading out Joe's paper, and there it was written, 50 kV was needed. Okay, but we were quite happy. This was a manipulator here, and down here are the fusion cells. And I told you this was a vertical system here, and I don't want to go into details because you will hear about more about this here, where the fusion cell shroud was by Albrecht Fischer, about the untold stories, and also about the sample holder here. You had to build everything yourself. So it was a good training for us to learn how to build things ourselves. Okay, this was a new building, the Max Planck Institute. It looks the same as it looks today. And we were located here on the seventh floor. Here was our original laboratory. I'm talking about people mainly also here. So this was myself discussing in front of the MB system with Gottfried Döhler, who was appraising his idea of NIPI doping superlattices. Maybe Ray soon knows a story about that. He is going to talk about it. So this was in front of the MB system. So he tried to convince us to grow doping superlattices. Okay, this was a board of directors. Unfortunately, I don't have a picture from those early days. So the picture was taken in 1985. This here is Hans Kweiser, Ludwig Genzel, Manuel Cardona, Albrecht Rabenau. And we worked in the chemistry department of Albrecht Rabenau. And this is Klaus von Klitzing here, who came in 1985. They were celebrating, I think, the Nobel Prize for him at that occasion. Okay, so these were our first publications. And it's very interesting. In the first 3 years, we had no publication at all. And the project was extended, fortunately. So this was our first publication here, which we were applying our in situ characterization technologies. So the first real important publication was related to the hemp structures. So we could show for the first time that even in single heterojunction, modulation doped single heterojunctions, a two-dimensional electron gas was generated, which could be depleted by applying a bias via a Schottky gate. Yeah. So this was the first demonstration of this two-dimensional electron gas. It was published in Physical Review Letter in April 1979. I should mention it because my friend Satoshi Hiyamizu was here, we were also applying for a patent for application devices. But we were a little late because the patent division of Max Planck, there was some reorganization, so for 3 months nothing happened. So we were late in applying for a patent compared to Fujitsu and other companies. Okay, but maybe I was better off not to work with a patent and so on. Now, people, you know, I was lucky to find a very good technical engineer half a year after I started. So this is Albrecht Fischer here. And Harald Künzel, who was my first PhD student working in doping superlattices. And you know, we had a roasted pig here, which we were transporting to the fireplace here. You know, you need some good social life to please your good co-workers here. Okay, this picture was taken a little later. So at the left, you see our chairman of today. Yeah, it was in 92 at the International MBE conference in Schwäbisch Gmünd. This is Eric Tournier. Yeah, Harald Künzel here. Lutz Davritz and Albrecht Fischer here. Lutz Davritz was from the Institute in Berlin, to which I moved in 1992. Okay, the whole story sounds like this one. So I started coming from chemistry. It's something MBE. This is something, I translate this, the never-ending story. It was actually from a movie and from a book. It's a never-ending story of MBE. So I came from a chemistry laboratory. So the next picture shows you how it typically looks like. So this is a very typical chemistry laboratory in the old days. So then I went to the Max Planck Institute, and we got money to buy a huge system. So you buy a huge system here, you put in some materials here from the top, and then you get out something which you can use for some interesting physics, for some publications, and so on. So it's a never-ending story. And we have a lot of young people here. And we always ask advice, what could we recommend to young people? And this is my last view graph now. But don't take it for so important. So this all applies to the operators. But this applies to the funding agencies, and I think this is most important today. It's much more important than in the old days. I told you, we had no publication at all after 3 years, almost 3 years. And the first contract was for 3 years. But our supervisors and the managers trusted us. They gave us another contract for another 3 years. Then it turned out to become successful. Today, the funding agencies ask you to find a new device or a new application for something within 2 years or even 1 year. How can it be possible for such a difficult technology where you really want to try something new? Okay, this should be my message for today. Thank you very much. I think we are in time.
Thank you very much for getting us back in time. So,
yeah.
Okay, so now the next is Jim Harris is going to chair a panel.
Yeah, you.
So, Satoshi and John, Klaus, Tom. Oh, Klaus has not gone far away. Yeah, just bring. right.
So presumably this is working. You can hear me? Yeah or no? I need to shout louder. All right. No. We said we'll have lunch at 12:30. Is that right? So we got 32 minutes. Yeah, well, so maybe we'll get hungry sooner. So one of the things that I noticed from Klaus's talk, and something that has always puzzled me, and maybe you could provide some insight into the both the equipment people and the young people doing MBE today, is the question of vertical versus horizontal systems. And you know, there's still both kinds made, and I can remember my first machine was vertical, and I don't think I ever saw an oval defect, but maybe I just, there were so many other worse problems that it wasn't an issue. But as soon as we got a Gen 2 system and it was horizontal, oval defects became a real issue for device problems. And so I think there's still some question about oval defects and horizontal versus contamination. So maybe the collective wisdom of people here, you have an opinion you could share. As I say, it might be useful to both the equipment people and to the new people choosing machines. Anybody want to tackle that?
One comment, if you use pyrolytic boron nitride for the gallium cell, you don't get oval defects.
Oh yeah, you do.
We didn't do.
So, but yours was a vertical machine.
No, we had in between, we had horizontal also. We had both. But I think today, with today's technology, vertical system is much easier, much less complex. For the substrate heater, everything, transfer systems. And you can transfer the wafer upside down so that nothing can fall onto your wafer during transfer. Very easy, and with the linear shutters today, they are clean, no rotation, nothing like that.
Yeah, I really think the history is like this. At the beginning, when we designed the MBE system, we try to make it vertical. The reason is because we worry about, from the surface physics study end of it, we worry about impurities of the oven being contaminated by. If you go vertical, evaporation, we worry about things will fall into the diffusion cell with time, because you see the system, you'll be crushed all over, different places may have something fall into the oven, which is our concern. And of course, when I finally go into these production MBE systems, the transfer in wafers from platen to platen definitely, this vertical system is a lot easier to design the system for the substrate holding. When you go from one platen to the next platen, so for mass production system, I think there's not much choice but vertical evaporation. And the thing we worry about is not contaminating our diffusion cells. This is the thing that we constantly are arguing with production and manufacturing. This is the thing that's when we started beginning design MBE, that's why vertical, we were horizontal evaporation, worry about it. But the pros and cons on how to transfer the wafer from wafer, there's not that much you can do. The thing is, you worry about the other things that which coming down from the top of the chamber, but you see the pattern of the new substrate coming in, they will prevent the one from the other place from falling upside down. It's upside down, therefore protecting that falling upside down.
Horikoshi, do you have a thought?
Concerning the growth of MEE diffusion sequence, the horizontal shutters are very useful for lifetime is extremely long. And also, normally we use a magnetic system for the shutter action. In that case, it affects the beam position of the screen. And dynamic process of deposition, we need very, you know, stable beams. So screening of the you know, shielding of magnetic field is very important for shutters.
So I think one of the issues was Satoshi, you have
just a very small comment. recently, people used the commercially available MB system, but we can't change the machine by myself. So in old days, we can design and we changed and improved the machine. So it's a very big pressure. So.
Okay, so at least I think one of the issues that John asked about is, you know, in for a lot of the production machines, the doping and things is at a higher level quite often. So, but if you look, at least to my knowledge, like Lauren Pfeiffer's machine and probably Tom's early machine, I don't know, where they were able to get really high mobility, these super high mobilities, I suspect those are still all horizontal research machines where that issue of contamination may be less, but I think it is still probably an issue, but clearly the design is simplicity for production machines is favors the vertical machines. So one other question I thought is clearly Satoshi had the guillotine hanging over his head. It was clear he had to pick something, some device that he could make in a hurry, but I thought maybe, you know, you guys, Klaus worked on the nippy structures and Al worked on early majority carrier devices, but the driving force was lasers. So have you got some insight? What drove your, how did you decide what to do as you kind of were moving? You guys were mostly the pioneers and really did a lot of the work on the early development of the material science, but eventually we had to prove that this was going to be useful for making high performance devices, things that couldn't be done by LPE in particular. That was the dominant epitaxy technology at the time. How did you choose which device to go after? This might be useful for the young people trying to decide, what am I going to do?
Well, in my case, it was a different driving force. I mean, we had three physics departments. They all wanted to get wafers for doing interesting physics in gallium arsenide or other materials. So that was the main driving force. The device was, I would say, on second place in our case. But okay. Tom is different.
Yeah, in our case, it was different. It was a mixture. I mean, the driving force was for high quality material for physics experiments, but at the same time, making lasers. So we were told at the time, you can't have beryllium in a high mobility machine. It's nonsense. But I mean, so it was a combination of drives from industry and drives from physics people, yeah.
Al, how did you choose to jump from one to the other?
Well, to me, again, is I was so fortunate to work at Bell Laboratories and so many different experts around me that beyond my own imagination, I cannot do it by myself. But then there are so many different people. Like I was mentioning in my talk, Franz Reinhardt, doing both the photonic devices and electronic devices with me, and he finds that my photonic operation, this material is simply no good at that time. But then he can suggest that I can go into majority carrier devices to first demonstrate some result to show the boss, and then I can survive for another year and then find another one. As you can see in Bell Labs, competition is extremely keen. And although they gave you the freedom to do research, but they want to know, what did you do with yours? It's not free. And then the competition is, in the evaluation each year, we were ranked from number one to number last, fourth ranking. The bottom 10% is so-called stimulated resonation, as you please go. And so it's extremely keen. So you have to constantly show some progress. And to the new generation, you ask one thing, well, where should we go? And to me, I think for the new generation, first of all, you look at MBE. What are the characteristics, special characteristics MBE can do other people cannot do? One thing is, very obviously, we can grow at lower temperature than most other crystal growth, like MOSB other people can do. So we can develop the overgrowth of 3-5 compound high mobility, electron mobility things on top of silicon integrated circuit already completed. Then no other crystal growth can do the hybrid growth of these high electromobility 3-5 compound on existing silicon integrated circuit. Other things like antimony compound, many other ways difficult to grow. MBE can go into antimony. There's a lot of different things like energy conversion. How do you store energy? How do you thermal electric area? There's another new branch of MBE going to thermoelectric conversions. So these are new things. You want to look at MBE can grow under non-equilibrium thermodynamic condition. So with your imagination, what new material can grow? What temperature can grow? So these are the things you want to think about that these old folks earlier, they didn't do it yet. So you can write a new chapter for MBE.
Okay, so in the Fujitsu companies, I always require that new result. And MBE produce new material. New material is new. New is just a good one, but we always require high quality and device quality. It can be applied device. So new material and high quality is a very important thing. Really great.
Everybody can hear that. Can you grow single monolayers of material like stannine or graphene or topological insulators, where you're not talking about just monolayer fluctuations, but the growth of absolutely single monolayer of material? So. Let's ask Horikoshi-san if he has an idea about that, since he's pioneered the growth of alternate layers.
Yes, for the depending upon the materials, but the if you choose some material, a monolayer growth can be possible, because you know at moderatory or lower temperatures, you deposit the metals. This usually maybe of course the some temperature is needed, but you can obtain monolayer surface coverage.
Well, that I'd like to put my vote
sure.
in.
All right.
For, I'm not a device person, but I do like to study surfaces, and it seems to me that MBE has always been a great way to study atomic processes taking place on surfaces. And so in order to do the kind of monolayer probing that this gentleman is talking about, we need to have methods that can determine whether or not we've got one monolayer. So I think that there's there are a lot of excellent studies that can be done that don't need large wafer size, just in order to try to answer questions like have been raised here.
So I have a sort of follow-up question with two physical chemists here. At least a lot of that for these kind of materials like silane or stannine that are single atomic layers of group four materials that looks like they need to be functionalized and that it's not just a simple deposition that is going to work. So do you have any advice or thoughts about how to proceed on that area? No. All right, so there's a good challenge for all you young people at some new things how to work on these single atomic layer materials, as they seem to be the hot topic these days with topological insulators. And
I wanted to say something, and this is a question. MBE, he's a grower. What are his chances for a career in academia or even in a company? I think that's a big issue. If he does all these nice buzzwords, physics or devices, he certainly will have papers in high impact journals. He will make a career. But an MBE grower, to my experience, and this has not changed much, his career chances in academia were extremely poor.
Sure, Ray. Yep. Right, but it's a single layer material too, like stannine and things. Yeah. Putting sulfur in your MBE machine sounds almost as bad as putting mercury in. So we've kicked around a few things here. Are there some questions? We had one. Let's see if there's another brave soul out there. We'll give somebody else a chance if they've got a question. If not, we'll be back to you. Yeah. I can hear it and I can repeat the question or maybe you can give.
Oh yes. So today we heard a lot of very nice story about early days of MBE system. So Archu has showed very nice demonstration about this MB, the impact of MB on the basic physics and also the device. So actually my question here is that how about the MBE for nanotechnology, because I remember that a couple of years ago there is a paper on Nature Nanotechnology with the title MBE deserves the historical places for nanotechnology. So I wonder that if all the pioneers can give some kind of the your views on how important and what kind of the contribution for the MBE on the nanotechnology.
Well, I'll let others answer too, but I would say we unfortunately were too slow on, we've been growing nanostructures for many years, but we just didn't put the right buzzword to it. But my bias is to believe it's really been one of the foundations for it. But I think we were negligent or just too slow to put the right buzzword, so other people got there first. But certainly MBE was probably the first to really make true nanostructures. Al?
In my talk at the end there, I did say the international first nanotechnology prize was given to MBE. It was Putin started that prize. That prize was supposed to be not only just to make smaller sizes, you get the so-called nanotechnology prize. Well, the first guy who did a one atom layer, that obviously the smallest thing, he should get the nano prize. But Putin put down the requirement is you make small dimension devices, and also it's been useful. So in that prize, he gave the theoretical calculation and the MBE demonstration of small devices in the Rust Nano Prize 2009 years. And also gave the manufacturing company, like Revere, got the nanotechnology manufacturing equipment prize. So that's what Russia gave in 2009.
Any other? So, Anna Palm.
I have two comments. One relating to the question the young gentleman from there asked about honest 2D things. When I get a chance in the afternoon, I'll say a few things about it, but I want to remind everybody that the Reed oscillation is the ultimate proof of how you do exactly that. And that is, you define the length scales on which you're interested, and then if you have a vicinal surface and you create conditions so that atoms migrate to the step, oscillations do not occur. And that is a clear indication that you have a single layer, except that it is on a vicinal, so you can adjust the terrace width. And if that is good enough for your device, then that is what matters, because you're going to pattern it and carve it after the fact anyhow. So why don't you do it right from the beginning? And this has been done back in 1985 or so. The second matter, which has to do with MBE and its role in nanotechnology, and what, of course, Dr. Cho mentioned, I guess that's the Russo Nano 2009. I think the thing that we need to understand as a community of MBE or even MOCVD, et cetera, namely the semiconductor epitaxy community, the word nano, nanotechnology, nanomaterials for the world is dominated by nanomaterials as defined by chemists in traditional colloidal chemistry and things like that. So we can try to carve a place for MBE within our community as opposed to perhaps other techniques, and it has its rightful place. I'm a practitioner of that, but I can tell you I have for about a dozen years or more worked with Paul Olivisato, who's one of the founders of the colloidal chemistry-based stuff, and we have worked for at least 15 years on the integration of these two technologies and what that can do, etc. So I think when we think about nano in general, we have to think of that larger picture.
Sure.
Just a quick comment on that. I think that award to the nanotechnology award to MBE really is great award. I think MBE field deserved that. Why? Because I remember when I was a student and I see nanowires. When the machine's dirty, the wafer is dirty, you got a nanowires, and we got embarrassed. So I said, oh, you got a nanowires, your machine's terrible. But I think nowadays, of course, now we interpret that in a very different way.
The nanotechnology includes many aspects, of course. But I told the quantum dot formation. In such case, the very small structure cannot be formed on the photolithography or electron beam lithography, but we made it on the pyramids. Yeah. So MBE is so clean ambient. Therefore, the flying coming atoms look very tiny change difference with the surface energy. So when we get a small dot of indium arsenide on gallium arsenide pyramid, it is the structure is the pyramid is formed by 110 equivalent faces, and on the top 001. The surface energy of 110 and 001 is different, but difference is very small. But still, atoms can get disposition. So I think ambient is very clean. Therefore, the atoms can get very good position on the surface. So when you like to make tiny structures, I think MBE is very good, I think.
So yeah, I have a very quick comment to the question by the audience. I think the Professor Maduka talked about the use of the Reed oscillation. You can identify the layer by layer growth. For these 2D materials, like bismuth selenide, one unit cell, one quintuple layer, and a two quintuple layer have a very different band structure. If you have one unit cell or one the quintuple layer bismuth selenide or ion selenide superconductor, two quintuple layer and two unit cell and one unit cell will be very different. So by the transport and the band structure measurement, you can identify whether you have one unit cell or two unit cell and so on. Graphene, same thing. One layer graphene and a two layer graphene will have very different band structure. I think that's.
So one of the things working with quantum dots and trying to make, literally a n cubed the refractive index volume laser. If that's ever really going to be useful, we're going to have to find a way to pattern and put the quantum dots where we want them. Various of us have tried that, and then the quantum dots are not good at all. So our colleagues resort to hunting with the electron microscope to find where they define their photonic crystal structure around a given quantum dot. So do you have any insight as to how one might be able to ultimately really create quantum structures in a patterned way that could be useful for device technology? Ah.
Well, you didn't get an answer of your question, but this is a different question.
Well, let's see if anybody has a quick idea about that. No? It's a tough problem, huh? All right.
I guess the quantum mechanics also get to us down to that nanoscale. Fluctuations kill us in terms of the precise control of the quantum positioning as well as the size.
Right. Size is important.
Yeah, size is important. First of all, I wanted to second the comment just being made. Actually, the student who asked the question was my student. We have been working on those 2D crystals. It is absolutely not possible to tolerate more than 0.01 monolayer roughness in terms of those 2D crystals. Therefore, one monolayer, half monolayer roughness couple of speakers have mentioned using read to detect is not tolerable in those material systems. So this is a different question. My question is, Tom raised this question, what happened to chemical beam epitaxy? Why it died? I wanted to hear your opinion. Why it died? Do we have a chance to revive it? Because I'm believing in it may have some applicability in terms of developing 2D materials. That's why I asked this question.
I guess I have an opinion is that one of the big problems is just if you're doing things at low temperature, you always get a huge amount of carbon incorporation because you can't pyrolyze the metal alkyls. It could be possible with things like silicon because people are using, disilane and I've forgotten that there's a silane thing that has like six silicon atoms in a molecule, and it really breaks up at much, much lower temperatures. And so there may be some complex precursors that could eliminate that. But that's really been the problem, I would say. But I see Chris has he's been one of the people that has worked a lot on this, so he could have a good view of this.
My comment is actually it's not dead, it's still going on, but it's an order of magnitude more difficult than MBE to keep it. And really, substrate temperature is the biggest killer. To do a quaternary, you need 5-degree temperature control. That's your temperature window to keep composition. So the real thing is not that you can't keep doing it, it's just more difficult to do. Right? And I think it's going to come back. It is coming back. I mean, just hasn't died. It's just dormant for a little bit.
Well, you could say it's alive in an atomic layer.
I think selective array growth and
right.
ALE is sort of, and if you're going to do a new material, it is so much more difficult to find the growth conditions. It's not like MBE, you can do read oscillations, everything sticks. Your sticking coefficient depends on chemistry. So you can actually be in a mode where I've actually been it. I had 95% indium in one part of a sample and 5% at the other side. You just put yourself in the right condition, you get chemistry really dominating.
Right. I would say the other is that, there's virtually 5 nines or 6 nines pure elements of almost every element on the periodic table, but any of these require really complex chemistry to develop high purity materials for your sources. So that can add several years to the process compared to just ordering 5 nines or 7 nines material. Okay, so maybe this will be the last question back here. It looks like we have about 1 minute to when we're supposed to go eat lunch, so your last question here. Okay, so the question is MBE advantageous? I see somebody shaking their head here who has probably the most experience in the room on that issue, so I'm going to let Mort Panish make a comment.
Well, I've been out of this action for 22 years, so it's a little difficult, but I was surprised to hear the comment that it's dead. I didn't think it should be dead. I had a lot of success with it, doing what I wanted to do, but the requirements have become much stiffer because people are trying to do more difficult stuff now. But I think and I hope it'll come back, but I really don't have a clue as to whether it really will.
Thank you, Mort. As Charles says, the conference is dead, but not the research and technology on it. Oh, that's all MOCVD. Yeah. They don't have enough nines added onto it. Okay, I think with that we should close the session. I would certainly like to thank all of the speakers. It was really a tremendous effort, and to Yonghang for really being the focus of getting us together and organizing this. So we'll have lunch break. What time do you want to start?
30 minutes for lunch, we probably have to rush a little bit.